Rifaximin is a gastrointestinal-selective antibiotic that has an excellent safety profile with minimal drug interactions. Rifaximin is a bactericidal drug with a broad spectrum of antimicrobial activity and with minimal impact on the intestinal microbiota. So let's explain these features step by step. First of all, why rifaximin considered gastrointestinal-selective antibiotic? Because it's a non-absorbable oral antibiotic. When a patient intake rifaximin, rifaximin comes into the intestine, and the signature feature of rifaximin is that rifaximin practically do not undergo any absorption into the blood. So basically, all the rifaximin that was taken remains in the lumen of the intestine, and this creates a huge concentration of the rifaximin in the small and large intestine. But also this results in extremely small concentrations of rifaximin in the blood. Studies with radio-labeled rifaximin have demonstrated that after oral injection of rifaximin, less than 0.4% of rifaximin enters into the blood and 97% recovered unchanged in the stool. Before the rifaximin mechanism of action, why rifaximin is so safe? There is a very simple reason. With lack of systemic absorption, rifaximin concentration in the blood is very low. And the lower is the concentration in the blood, the lower is the chance that rifaximin will enter into the any other tissue in the body. So rifaximin basically has no systemic effects. And because of that, the incidence of adverse events is low. In addition to this, the lower is the rifaximin concentration in the blood, the lower is the probability that rifaximin metabolism will interact with the metabolism of any other drug. So drug interactions with rifaximin are uncommon. And because of that, no dose adjustments of rifaximin are required in case of hepatic dysfunction, even with liver failure and hepatic encephalopathy. So we do not need to correct the dose of rifaximin with liver dysfunction. So overall, the lack of absorption of rifaximin in the GI tract increases fecal concentrations of this drug and limits its systemic toxicity. That's why rifaximin is safe for use in children as well. So what is the mechanism of action? Rifaximin is a non-systemic structural analog of rifampin that inhibits the synthesis of bacterial RNA by binding to the beta subunit of bacterial DNA-dependent RNA polymerase. So rifaximin is a bactericidal drug. To explain this, we have to know that DNA-directed RNA polymerase, also known as DNA-dependent RNA polymerase, is responsible for the polymerization of ribonucleotides into a sequence complementary to the template DNA. In other words, the genetic information in bacterial DNA has to be copied to RNA molecule and carried to ribosomes where proteins are produced. So we have this central dogma of molecular biology, DNA-RNA-protein. DNA molecule is composed of nucleotides that are organized in two strands. First DNA strand called coding strand and second non-coding strand. And to use this information in the gene, information must be carried to ribosomes where proteins are made. So DNA molecule for this purpose makes a copy of the gene in form of pro-matrix RNA molecule. This process called transcription, and transcription is provided by the bacterial DNA-dependent RNA polymerase. And bacterial DNA-dependent RNA polymerase consists of five major subunits. 2 alpha, 1 beta, 1 beta prime, and 1 omega. So DNA-dependent RNA polymerase use complementary to DNA non-coding strand nucleotides. And this results in production of pro-matrix RNA molecule. Let's suppose that our sequence of nucleotides located in a coding region, this is called exon. So this sequence of nucleotides will not be removed by RNA splicing, and in form of matrix RNA molecule will be delivered to ribosomes. Ribosomes read nucleotide sequence in matrix RNA molecule in codons and include complementary to that codon amino acid. And by this principle, bacterial ribosomes form protein. And let's suppose that this protein is an enzyme, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase, that participates in bacterial glycolysis. And glycolysis is the major source of energy for bacteria. For anaerobic bacteria, it's the only source of energy. So what rifaximin is doing, it irreversibly binds to the beta subunit of the bacterial DNA-dependent RNA polymerase. As a result, the function of DNA-dependent RNA polymerase becomes disrupted, so this enzyme cannot provide the transcription. As a result, information in the DNA molecule cannot be copied to RNA, thereby pro-matrix RNA molecule cannot be formed. As a result, protein cannot be produced. So basically, rifaximin inhibits the bacterial ability to synthesize proteins. It can be any protein, but because we took a protein that participates in glycolysis, this inability to produce this protein, now glycolysis becomes impossible. Thereby, bacteria will be unable to produce any energy, and severe energy deficiency will inevitably cause bacterial death. So that's why rifaximin has a bactericidal effect. In other words, that's why rifaximin can kill the bacteria. And important that rifaximin can kill a broad array of enteric pathogens, including gram-positive, gram-negative, aerobic and anaerobic bacteria. Now, to understand in which conditions rifaximin can be used, we have to know that the activity of some bacteria in intestine can lead to some unfavorable complications. First of all, non-invasive E. coli by production of exotoxins can cause so-called traveler's diarrhea. Severe increase in amount of pathogenic bacteria in intestine called small intestinal bacteria overgrowth. Cirrhosis is commonly associated with small intestinal bacteria overgrowth. And the problem is that in cirrhosis, the gut barrier becomes more permeable. So bacteria in cirrhosis can translocate from the lumen of the intestine into the mesenteric lymph nodes or other extraintestinal organs. And this greatly increases the risk of complications, for example, the risk of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. Also, bacteria can deaminate proteins, and this results in production of free ammonia that can diffuse from the intestine into the blood and then cross the blood-brain barrier and enter into the brain tissue, a condition known as hepatic encephalopathy. So the higher the amount of bacteria in the intestine, potentially the more severe is hepatic encephalopathy. Also, as we know, bacteria can modulate gut immune signaling, and increase in amount of pathogenic bacteria in case of small intestinal bacteria overgrowth disrupts normal gut immune signaling, and this can cause irritable bowel syndrome. Because for now we certainly know that small intestinal bacteria overgrowth play an important role in pathogenesis of irritable bowel syndrome. The clinical syndromes of irritable bowel syndrome and small intestinal bacteria overgrowth overlap, and between 40-80% of irritable bowel syndrome patients have an abnormal hydrogen breath test or increased small bowel bacterial counts. So when we prescribe rifaximin, rifaximin due to its bactericidal effect kills the intestinal bacteria. Because rifaximin can kill non-invasive E. coli, currently rifaximin is a drug of choice for the treatment of traveler's diarrhea. Because rifaximin can kill a broad array of enteric pathogens, including gram-positive, gram-negative, aerobic and anaerobic bacteria, rifaximin appears to be an ideal choice for the treatment of small intestinal bacteria overgrowth. Because irritable bowel syndrome can be caused by small intestinal bacteria overgrowth, in patients with irritable bowel syndrome, antibiotics as rifaximin can be prescribed. And in fact, after antibiotic treatment, clinical improvements of irritable bowel syndrome symptoms appears to be associated with normalization of hydrogen breath test. Rifaximin can be used in treatment of patients with cirrhosis, because by decreasing amount of bacteria, we prevent bacterial translocation, thereby we decrease risk of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. And also by decreasing amount of bacteria, we decrease ammonia production by the bacteria, thereby we prevent hepatic encephalopathy. And for the treatment of hepatic encephalopathy, rifaximin is generally used in combination with lactulose. Now there is one crucial concept. Currently, rifaximin is a drug of choice for the treatment of traveler's diarrhea caused by non-invasive Escherichia coli. But the key here is the word non-invasive. It turns out that rifaximin has one serious weak spot. Rifaximin cannot kill invasive bacteria. The reason is that rifaximin is non-absorbable antibiotic. And because rifaximin cannot be absorbed, rifaximin's bactericidal activity appears to be limited to the lumen of the GI tract. So if bacteria is present in the lumen of the GI tract, rifaximin will kill it. But if only bacteria will invade into the tissues, rifaximin becomes totally useless. If you like content, please press like and subscribe button. All the best!